And then because the most significant bit is also zero, and the n flag depends on the most significant bit, so this one is also zero. Okay, so this one done already for case one. And then if case two, when it's exclusive or, this is case two, right? Then actually, you know, your zero and zero is zero. Your now there is a zero and one, which is a one, and then you know the whole thing will repeat. But the moment that you see a one there, you know that it cannot be zero. Okay. And then if you go all the way here, zero exclusive or zero is definitely zero. So here is also not negative, right? So this case should be very easy to handle, right? Okay. So you can just sort of go down. Let's now consider this more complicated case. Or maybe I won't. I'll consider this more complicated case where everything is 1 in R2. So if I were to rub off the values inside there. Rub off all these values. And put everything 1 inside. So when you end it together, quite easy to see that whatever is zero all becomes zero, whatever is one and one becomes one, so you probably end up with a 1 0 1 0, and then the rest all zeros. And then you can answer the same question again. Is it negative? No. Is it zero? Also no, right? So, and then the other case, exclusive or, you have, is it negative? Okay, do you think it's negative? How many of you think it's negative? One or two of you think it's negative? How many of you don't think it's negative? Actually, it will be negative because you see this one here and this zero here in the most significant bit.
Oh yeah.
The one and the zero becomes a one. So I will end up with a one there. I will end up with a one here. And then here will be negative. And then because it is definitely not zero, so that is equal to zero. Okay. So this is definitely. Because of the one there, because of the one and zero here, and you're exclusive of, it's going to be exclusive of. Okay, then the third case is an A. Okay, I think I don't need to write that down, you can do it mentally. Just imagine 1 0 1 0 sitting here, the rest all zeros. You add it together, clearly it's going to be 1 0 1 0. And then this thing won't be one, right? This one would be
zero.
Okay. Now, when you exclusive it all, when you exclusive all together, okay. Imagine now here is 1 0 1 0 in this case. So it's exactly the same. So in the bits where, so it's basically 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0. So the result over here is, when it's this and this exactly the same, the whole thing will be 0, right? So Z will be equals to 1. So Z will be equals to 1. But what about N? The whole thing will be 0, so clearly definitely it's not negative. So N is equals to 0. So So these are the sort of tricky cases that will emerge. Like I said, I didn't write out the 1010 there, but if you write out 1010, they're exactly the same. You will see that you know, the whole thing, everything will be zero, and then therefore this z equals to one, and the most significant bit is zero, so n. So make sure you sleep well the night before the exam. If you go there half drunk or half asleep, you probably won't have a clear mind. Okay, but if you have a clear mind, I expect you to score full marks. Right? This is so called a simple start. Did someone call me? Okay.
The first one is
all right, now let's move on to something more fun.
More fun.
Coding.
Something more fun is assembly language questions.
Oh my god, what's this?
Okay, everybody is agreeing that.
What the fuck?
Keep borrow.
Okay, this is something that I expect you to write in less than half an hour. 15 marks only, right? So maybe 20 minutes. So write an ARM assembly language program. Now, first of all, you have to understand what the question is looking for. So make sure you don't misunderstand the question. So you want to compute approximately x bar and variance s squared of a list of n integers 1 to n, which are stored in main memory, starting at location numbers. Don't be shy to draw diagrams. See, the question paper is there, right? So just draw diagrams. Favorite is draw rectangles. So this is memory. Whatever the address is, you are told that it is as a label numbers. Alright. Okay, so it has some values, maybe it has 6 values, let's say. However many. 1, 2, 3. Okay, these are the values inside. It can be any value. Okay. Let's say the there are 6 values, and also the value of n is stored at location n. So somewhere else, some other address, don't care. You have the number of values. Here is 6 values there, and then the number 6 is inside there. Okay. Now you need to calculate the mean and the variance. Now, the story or the application will change. So as long as you understand what's going on, you should be able to write the program for it. And then you're given a formula. So basically, it tells you the mean is obtained, as all of us know, by adding out all the numbers, 1 plus 2 plus 3, and divide by the number of numbers. So the sum of this divided by 6. So you write an assembly language program to do this. Okay. And then the variance something more complicated, and so on. Okay, so how should you start? Right. Now chances are when I write the program, the first instruction is LDR. But don't be fixated on that. First of all, you analyze the logic, right? Do you think it will involve some loops or not? It will probably involve some loops, right? Because I have to... this is in memory. Memory is dumb. You have to like get the numbers one by one to the processor side of things. And you have a number of registers that you need to use. Right, R, something. And that's why I say normally the first thing you write will be a load, because these things have to come inside here. And the only way to make this happen is an LDR, right? So you have to get stuff from memory into processor before you can do anything. So you sort of, after all the experience and practice that you had, work out the logic roughly in your mind, or jot it down on a paper or whatever. So how does the logic go? Now you probably have to initialize some registers, okay? So you probably have to initialize the label value, put it somewhere so that you can use one of the earlier addressing methods that we talked about, right? And then this will probably tell me how many times to loop. And then if there's a loop, right, what instruction is always present in a loop? You have a conditional branch, right? So surely there'll be conditional branch. And then because you are decrementing a counter, surely subtract is there somewhere. And then because you are subtracting, and you want to stop when you hit zero, it would be a subtract with an S suffix, for example. Right? So you know all these things will be there. But definitely you need to initialize some registers with these label values. And we know how to do that, right? We can just do LDR, some register, and equals number. And then I will know what address this number one is sitting in. Right. So usually there's some initialization. So that you know that we know that there'll be addition involved. We know there'll be division involved. Now, then the next question is, so don't jump into writing a program straight away. Think about it a little bit. Why is, because essentially what we are trying to get you to learn is the skill of logical thinking also. Okay? How many times do you think we need to do the loop? Do you think one pass round these numbers is enough to calculate both values? And actually at the end, right, to look at the last part of this question, it should be stored at memory location starting from location answer. So actually there's some more stuff. So somewhere else, there's some address, and then this thing is labeled called answer. And then I'm gonna store the mean inside here. I'm gonna store the variance inside that. Okay. So definitely str is going to be involved. I'm going to need this value inside a register, so inside a base register, so that I can do str. Right? Okay. So if you were to write the program, I didn't bluff you, right? First thing you write is LDR. Actually, you go in, close your eyes, write LDR, maybe you'll score too much.
Just bring down.
Into his computer. So LDR. So program counter relative load. Right? So this one will tell you how many times you load. And then this one tells you where to get the numbers from. This one tells you where to put the answer. Right. And then you know you want to do some addition. So you initialize it. Okay, I told you that there are two loops. I didn't tell you, but I hinted that there's more than one loop. So the two loops. The first loop is to calculate. Okay, or the first part is to calculate the mean. Now Now the reason why I have to do it in two separate loops and not one loop is because I need the value of the mean over here. So I have to finish calculating this one first, store it here, then I will run the loop again because these values are actually stored in memory. Then I have to subtract it and square it and add them together and get the second value to put here. So once you figure out the logic, then it's quite straightforward, right? So you will do the post index addressing. It's probably very convenient to use, right? So this one I just step through one by one. You add it together. You decrement the loop counter, and then if you haven't hit zero yet, you go and load and add the next one until you hit zero. Then you've added up all the numbers, right? All the six numbers that, like, for example, you have added up. So after that, because I've lost my R0 value, I need to load it again. Then I just do a sign division because it may be negative, so I need to do a sign division. So my final answer for the mean is in R5. I just store it in the answer because when I hit that part, I will have finished, and then my mean comes inside here already. I finish this part. Then I start the second part. I reset my counter. I go to the top of the list again. I clear my accumulator. Again, I load one by one. But this time, I have to subtract this R5 value. And then I have my R6 value. Then I can use multiply with accumulate to multiply them together to get the square, right? And then I have a running total R4. My running total R4. So now my final R4 will have the variance value. I need to divide first. So once again, I load it again, I subtract by one because here I subtract by one. Okay. I do the division and then I store. And then when I store the variance. Okay. And then this is just, you don't really need to write this. So can or not? 20 minutes can do this, right? More than enough time. Provided you practice. It's just like solving a math problem. If you don't practice, you take you 1 hour to do. After you practice, wow, 20 minutes can do it. Okay, so now most of the questions follow this kind of format. So let me give you another example. But maybe before I go to another example, any questions on this? Not too difficult, right? Okay, another example.
Oh, all these questions are out of queue.
Now this Fahrenheit to centigrade conversion is something that all of us learn in primary school, right?
No, because the latest one is way harder.
It's easier. He reduced it.
Right, assembly language program.
He reduced the
Don't
increase,
miss this up.
But he's
if you
already,
write a program
whatever come out now will come out again.
Then
you can go and check
if
it will never be repeated.
They
will never be repeated.
Convert a list of n temperature values. So
that's
once again, you have a list of
n
temperature values. You can picture. That's why I say draw rectangles with
rectangles.
Now this time the n is not a label, but
so
essentially
BL
the n
value. Retrieve.
Thank you. So end temperature values, you want to convert Fahrenheit to centigrade using this well-known formula. Now it's possible to have positive and negative temperature values. And the value of N is actually stored in memory location N, so maybe here, so maybe you have like 10 values or something. And then now assume that each Fahrenheit temperature, each of the values has two decimal places.
Got a pro and con, no? Some modules I like, some modules I don't like.
Now,
there will be no
one sort
no
of
major that
thing that you can note is that in your assembly language programs, we never needed to deal with floating point values with decimals and so on. So,
I got exposed to mechanical
when you see decimal with assembly language, you have probably scaled it up by 100 or something like that.
But I don't think it's the same.
Although, when you write the program in C, you can have a floating point. Even on the Cortex-M3, and that's because there's the floating point functionality in the C library. But when you deal with raw assembly language, we won't make it so complex for all of you and ask you to deal with floating point numbers. So the sort of comforting thing to note is that in assembly language questions, you don't have to deal with floating point. And if you are asked to deal with floating point, that means you just scale it and so on. It doesn't mean that the LPC-1769 cannot handle floating point, because clearly I think some of you would have written floating point calculations in your C program and they do work. So this one, these temperature values are first converted into a convenient form and stored at successive locations in memory. Okay. So this converted in a convenient form basically just means that it has been scaled already. So like for example, if you have 50.17 degree Fahrenheit, it will probably be stored as 5017. So it doesn't matter as long as it's consistent. And then it's basically all the values are stored. So yeah, as long as you remember to divide this by 100. Now, sometimes the squaring may disturb your... Okay, this one has no squaring. The variance was a previous question. But sometimes when we do squaring and so on, remember that the scaling factor also squares. Okay, so if you actually square the temperature value, you will end up with a value that is 100 times 100, 10,000 times bigger. And then if you want to convert it back to centigrade, you have to divide by 10,000 rather than divide by 100. Okay. But in this case, no such thing. It's just a simple, you will find that there's no squaring. It's whenever you scale, of course you have to scale this one also. Okay, you have to scale this one also. This one is scaled, and then you multiply 5 and 9, the answer will be 100 times bigger. You just divide by 100 and you get your correct centigrade value. But if the formula was this thing squared, then on this side you are actually going to divide by 10,000, not divide by 100. Okay? Because if you square it, then obviously your scaling factor also gets squared. So you're going to store it. So anyway, inval is here. And then you're going to store the answer one by one, the centigrade value. You're going to store it starting from outval. Right? You're going to sort of all these values converted, you're going to put it there. And then assume necessary memory allocation has been done. and so on. Okay, again, don't jump into writing the code straight away. Do you think it involves any loops? Once again, I think once I show you two questions, you get the hang of things. Usually, when you walk, usually the first chances are the first instruction is going to be load again. Okay, you're going to load these guys into registers. And you're going to have a loop, you're going to have branch, you're going to have conditional, you're going to have stores. Okay. So it will look a bit like this. This program is shorter than the first one. Once again, I told you already, first thing is load. So different kinds of load. This is the PC relative load, this is the pseudo instruction load, because you want to get the addresses into R1, get the addresses into R2. And then remember, this 32 has to be scaled up. Okay. Now, my 5 over 9, right? I'm dividing 5 with 9. Even though the number is so small, I need to move them into registers. And by the way, as you all know, move doesn't involve any memory to processor. It's a direct value moving into the register solely within the processor. So this is the initialization part. All right, so as with any program, usually there's an initialization part. And then even though it's loop 2, there's only one loop. But then the key thing is I need to call subroutine. And all of you are experts in subroutine because you have so much experience in assignment 1. So standard format for subroutine, BL, jump over here. My actual conversion is there. So it's the Fahrenheit value that is in R3, right? Minus the 3200. So this R3 value is already 100 times bigger. So you, when you minus off this value, it's also 100 times bigger value. So this R8. And then I have to multiply by my 5. I have to divide. I need to do a sign divide because it may be negative. Answer in R4. So when I return from subroutine standard thing VXLR, my R4 has the answer. We will store it in memory. Okay. Decrement the counter and just repeat. Actually, it's very easy, right? I think all of you shouldn't have any problems. So like for example, the temperature values may be negative. Like 212 Fahrenheit. I mean, you're not expected to write down all these things, but I'm just telling you, if your input value is 21200, that means 212 Fahrenheit, it should convert to 10000 because 100 centigrade and then so on. Okay, so you don't do UDIF, you do SDIF. Okay, can do, right? 20 minutes, should be able to write this kind of program. Okay, now in the remaining time, I just want to go quick. Okay, so multiply by 100. I just want to show you a pin cell type of question. With assignment 2 very fresh in your mind, you probably are very familiar with pin cell. So let's say you want to enable this. Remember the pin function select, right? You have your pin cell registers. These are the bits that you input the values to choose function 00 or 01 or 10 or 11. And you are given this whole table in the question, right? So if you want to enable these four things, you want to enable these four things, right? And this is function 01. Now remember this, the initial or the current content of bin cell 4 is this. And you have to be careful not to modify the bits that are in other bit locations. You only modify what is necessary. Okay, so you have to be careful. So you only, if you want, you want to turn on these four things, you only should modify bits 20 to 27. So you go and count 20 to 27. You count 20 to 27. So if I count backwards, 31, 30, 29, 28, 27. So 8 bits. I want to change those 8 bits. Into 10 10 10. What I want is 0 1 0 1 0. I want my final thing to be here. And then the rest all unchanged, right? The rest all unchanged. Don't modify the rest. Write an ARM assembly language program to achieve this, assuming that the address is already in R0. So whatever pin cell 4 address is already in R0, right? So actually, this kind of, how would you write it? Remember, it's tricky when you have some ones here. If you go and oil in the desired bit pattern, it will still become 1 and you won't end up with 0. We covered this in tutorial questions, right? So what it will involve a two-step operation. What do we do in the first step? Clear it first, right? If we clear this 8 bits to 0 and then just oil it with this pattern, then you will get the desired result. But don't go and end, because 0 and all this will result in the 0 in the 8 bits. Okay. So to enable the 4 interrupts, bits 20 to 27 must be set to this, essentially this, without changing the other bits. In hexadecimal, you bother to sort of write it down, it's actually this. Okay. Bits 20 to 27 is this one, because the last one is 28, 29, 30, 31. Okay. So since the address is already there, you just load it in, clear these two guys, these 8 bits, all into this, and write it back. And that's all. Right? So pin cell type of questions is quite straightforward. Now, of course, you may also get GPIO type of questions. And we know that GPIO has a family of 5 registers, the set, the clear, the mask, the pin, the direction. We also have the interrupts for GPIO, rising edge, falling edge, clearing. So I think that's all. So I hope that has been useful.
You need to replace it.
I think the exam is quite late though. I think it's so 7th of December, right?
Yeah. Then you insert the number.
Okay, so I'll see all of you at the exam hall. Make sure you